My name is Sarit. Today, I'm going to talk about the Django backend from zero to deployment. This is a talk that I would like to introduce to any new guy to the Django world in order to get up to speed and build your own REST API and use it with your own backend as fast as you can. I intentionally to introduce this sort of material for a new one. So any Python level are welcome. Okay. Agenda. Why I will introduce first why I choose Python as a primary language. And next one I will introduce how the front end people consume the API endpoint and show you the benefit of Django ORM. In order to attract mobile development programmer, I will introduce a push notification because day-to-day mobile development has gained more feature, and one of the significant feature is a push notification. Many applications tend to have that feature in that way, so I will show the one to attract a new programmer to the Django world. And unit test is a crucial part for any back-end programmer. We have to know beforehand that our logic is good, permission is good, and new feature gonna break the existing one or not let it to become a problem when you go live into the production. And if we have time enough, I will introduce you how to do a Docker. Anybody here, have you ever heard about Docker? 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, Docker is good in terms of doing a container and deliver your product from the server side. It idealizes your environment, everything into one. Pack it into the Docker, ship it with image, and populate the container. Okay. Why Python? I divide it into four topics. It is first one from academic starting point, easy syntax, speed, and add-on. Let's see on the first one. From the academic starting point and easy syntax to understand, let's see in the detail what I mean. I myself start from physics. And I believe many people in the room here has a background from computer science and engineering. Mostly, engineering and science started from C, C++, Java, and Python. It is a really common track for people to get close to Python rather than JavaScript. If you are a JavaScript developer or web developer, you have to start from the web development. Start from HTML, CSS, and then JavaScript. Okay, this is my choice that why I start to study Python first. Next one, the computer speed. Now today, I observe and feel that computer has higher performance from the 10 years ago, 20. And in the future, I believe computer will go faster and faster, and computing power is cheaper. For example, Bitcoin. Have you ever heard about this term, Bitcoin? This is really, really fast growing in business in Thailand. Bitcoin itself has, if you would like to do a mining, you do just buy a computer rig, buy a hardware, and then invest your money. Let the Bitcoin surge up. Here, the same thing happened in the Moore's law. Observe from empirical data. This picture, I take it from Wikipedia, time sister count. Say it is a fact that computer always faster and faster. So the Python and performance advantage of Python and another language. For I myself, I care them, but it's not my significant concern at the first one. If I would like to do a faster software, I have two choices. First one, do an optimization as Python. Next one, change the algorithm. And the last one, change the programming language. But pre-optimization is root of all devil. Then I prefer not to do an optimization yet. I focus on the business value first. Okay, and by the product of easy to understand and computer has a performance improvement over the year, many people choose that. It is a fact that many people start to choose Python again and again. You can see from the Stack Overflow also mentioned that Python is a fast growing language in the forum. Okay. Here is a community and library. On the left hand side is a Django. Django reusable app always start with Django prefix. But it doesn't mean the Django plugin library no need to have a Django in front of it as a prefix. You can use just a simple name like MPTT or reversion or simple extension. No need to put prefix Django over there. But normally, it will show you, obviously, by put a prefix of Django in front of it. Oh, sorry, on the right-hand side, I use blue color. Is it difficult to see it now? Is it a purely Python framework in the field of machine learning? One of it is a PyTorch. I myself decided to use Python in order to get advantage from the machine learning framework. In the future, right now I have a skill of backend, I have skill of DevOps, and I have ReactJS, and the ultimate goal of I will use machine learning with the Python. Could get the data query from my database and then train my program and use it. So this is an advantage of using a Django with a Python language. Okay, this is an introduction why I choose Python and REST framework. Okay, next one I'm going to introduce you and how to create a backend REST system and show you how to use it from the beginning. Okay, it's gonna be long and technical detail. First one, pay attention on the one module. Let's say it is a menu of any ordinary shop, maybe food or drink. Okay, start by Python manage start app menus. It will ready made your entire menu has an init py admin model test and view API module you have to create by your own. Okay, the major files I'm going to talk about in the detail is model app setting, serializer and view set. Model is a representative of your data record. Okay. I am going to talk about the model size of the Django and record in the table of the database. Okay, it has term model represent the record in the database. Okay. And apps.py is it name of your application that your Django perceive. Next one is setting. After your Django perceive what is your application name is, you have to let it install to your Django system. Otherwise, you will not be able to apply your model schema to the database. Next one is a serializer. Serializer is a middle class to cooperate with your model and view set. View set is a class that get your get the incoming REST request and then respond back to the client. Okay, here is a simple model. Abstract class, I put abstract class. Here it's called abstract timestamp. It will keep track on your created time and updated time automatically by just a single by just a single line of code. No need to get manually change your value over the time if you take it for you. I declare it as a meta class. In the Python, you might not need to use meta class really frequent, but in the framework of Django, it makes use of meta class really frequent. You can see in, for this time, abstract, it means I don't want this class to be created to the database. I just would like it be to be an abstract one. Do not create it. And apply that schema when somebody or some model inherited. In this case, it is a menu. Menu inherit the abstract timestamp to it. That means menu will automatically have two generated fields. It is created at and updated at. Okay. Let me introduce a sample, a simple one. A character field, image field, and boolean field, and decimal field. Character field, you can put your max length, choice, and default. For a choice of menu type, I put it to food and drink. Actually, it has an easy way to do a choice in Django, but I decided to use plugin because it saves much more line of code and looks more cleaner in my eyes. Then I choose Django choice in here. Name, image, support image. Image view, I have a hint when you have to working with a image view. First one, do not let it be a null one. Always define your default image who handle that case and define the uploaded directory to keep it in one place of the field. Your project will look messy if you not let it has a upload directory or target. Take home, this is Boolean field. I always make a default value and rarely let my field has a null value in this because I hate null in my system. Always has a value in it. And the price is a decimal field. Whenever you deal with a money, in Python, if you are a Python programmer, especially in a scientific field, one of my friends, he's a nuclear researcher, and he used a float. And he asked me, what is the difference between float field and decimal field? Float field and decimal field, in a human perception, it has a decimal. It looks really the same. But technically, behind the scene, when you work with money, decimal field is preferred. It has its own technical behind the scene to evaluate the money in the same it is. Okay, that's all for a menu model. And then we have model, we have to put the name of it. In my setup, you can later on check out my repository to follow up my example and repeat my code. My setup is really plain simple. I put a menu module in the topmost. I don't put any another folder nested to it. Then my model name is really plain simple, just menu. For example, if you put your menu under the directory name apps, you have to put prefix apps in front of your menus and put dot to it. Okay, after your module has a name, has a model in that, you have to let the Django system itself install your application to it. Let's say put that name into the install apps list in here. It has a one convention in it. First of them will be a Django official modules. Next one will be an extension one, and the last one it will be your own application. Normally, I put them in an alphabetic order to see it in the line. Okay, that's all. Now, by this, your Django server knows that it has a menu module. Okay, next we almost there. We have to build a serializer, and the last one is a view set. The serializer is a middle class. Recap again, with middle class from the to work with model and deserialize the model, and then serve that data to the view set. Here is a model serializer. It's a menu serializer that I inherited from model serializer. It has manually. If it's up to you, you can use a serializer or you have choice to use a model serializer. It's based on you. If your logic is really complicated, you have to do your own customization, then serializer is your choice. But I always design my application one module, one model, and then I have one serializer to do the job. This is my approach. I simplify everything into one. So by that, I can take advantage of model serializer and make use of meta class. Okay, here again, we see the meta class has been using in the Django. Meta class will absorb all the complexity and automatically generate your view for your endpoint. And on the lower one is the example. Suppose if you would like to make your own serializer class, and you don't want to use a meta class that is already made for you, you have to make like this. Define one field by one, integer field, choice field, image field, boolean, and do not forget to implement your own method, like create, update, and partial update for patch. You have to do it by yourself. This is a technical advantage when you use a model serializer. Okay, we are almost there. This is a view set. View set has a variety of features in here. It has to get the connection from the requester. Then by that, you have to put a sort of permission, and you have to serialize the data back to the client, or even you have to get the input and put it to the database. Okay, start, and then after you have enough data, you do a query filter. Okay, by this, Django REST framework has a ready-made search filter and filter backend ready-made on it. But I use another extension come from Django filter. Django filter has a filter itself too. You can pay attention to the first line. I have to use alias from REST framework inside of Django field, and alias to be the filter, because if you choose wrong class, your filter is not gonna work. Okay. First one is really easy. You just adopt and inherit from model view set. Get the query, get the serializer, define your backend, then put the filter field, let them know what field you would like to do a filter in it, and what field you would like to do a search. It is a one different from filter and search. Search is mean, I'll start from filter first, because many people will be familiar with filter. Filter is mean you have to match the condition, all of them, into the one. Then the record will show up. But for search means at least one condition match, it will show up. So it is depends on your case with whether you use filter or you use search or not. There's Django support on that too. It can also search into the related relation from the model to another model too. Okay, everything set, we're ready to launch the view set and let the front end guy make consume on your view set. Okay. Apply your migration, apply your scheme to the database. Run your server. Run your server. Not run your server yet. Create super user first. And run your server. Run your server. Since this is on my development and I know how to do ReactJS, I choose it locally on my own. I just supply only run server and locally consume my own API. But if your team decided to use your computer as a backend and there are other guy in the room for web development, Android development, iOS development, and they would like to consume to your computer in your office, not far away to the internet. For example, in my company, we are cheap and we use just locally. Okay, you have to supply another argument. Let's say 0.0.0:8000 in order to let your firewall open the connection from the same network area and shoot to your computer. Okay, this is when you touch the API page, it will pop up your to log in into the system. This is a REST API backend. Okay. Now, REST framework is set. So, how to consume it? How to use it? I use this really simple one. It's called JWT. It stands for JSON Web Tokenization. JWT put in the header. Anybody here, if you're familiar with curl, is that okay? You can use a normally curl as a Unix-based requester and shoot the endpoint. But this time, I would like to get you have a visualization of the Postman application and shoot the endpoint. Okay, post into the URL, that given URL is based on your configuration, just in the URL.py. It's up to you what kind of URL you would like to use. Post, let it be a body, raw, and select to a JSON. In the JSON field, put username and password on it. And then post, response will be 200 and get back to you is a token. Token is not a fixed length. It depends on data, if on the data is generated. I normally not pay attention to that length because I grab that all and put it to the header. Okay, next, we have token ready. We are ready to consume now. We are authenticated now. If we don't supply the header to the endpoint, endpoint gonna say, okay, sorry, 403 permission denied. In the Django REST, if you say permission denied, not authentication denied, because authentication is absorbed already in the permission class. Okay, here is an example to query and get the result of the list view. Get has two meanings. First, get is a list view. List all the entire. Remember the view set that I showed to you a moment ago. It is a query set of the menu.objects.all. It will query all the entire of your record in your menu table. Okay. And this is a blank database. I put header authorization and prefix in the value by JWT, one space and paste token there. Get me back count, next, previous, and list of result. This is very easy. Easier than you do it manually in your Django. Normal Django, you have to use render. And render, you have to put your own paginator. Put your own search and re-render all the entire page again. It is not my choice to re-render all the entire page again because it is expensive to render all the same thing again. Then REST framework come to my choice, and okay, this is really fit to my need. If user has decorated all the menu, all the banner, all the website, and just would like to search, no need to hit all the entire page again. Just use REST framework, and here is what I want. Okay, we can get the result now. Okay, CRUD is an abbreviation form: create, read, update, and delete. Post, use. Okay. See on the lower side of the browsable API in here. This is a browsable API because you can browse it by your web browser. The same like the feature in the .NET, right? Everybody has an experience of .NET views. We understand this is a browsable API. Okay, you can put your record in here automatically. You have two choices. First one, just do a form and post it to here, or use a serializer and put your record into the system. Just simply input your data in there and post. This also support a variety of file format. And post return 201. 201 is mean instance has been created that and return back to you. Get. This is a second meaning of a get. Get has two action. First one is a list view, list all the entire, and get another one is a detail view. Do not confuse by the word get. Get has to get something. Okay, in this case is get on a detail of the object. You have to put something. For example, in this case, I choose default one. This is a primary key of the record. And serialize the model into a dictionary over here. For delete and update, you can do it in a single page of a detail view. Just click on the put button right there. And the first one, it will be a post. And after you post it, it turns to be a put. And delete as a danger button in the red on right hand side above. After you click it, it will confirm you one time. Are you sure you are going to delete a record from your system? Okay. To fasten my talk, the Django REST framework, it has a nested serializer and hyperlink identity read and read write control in order to fit your need. Life is not that simple. Business is not that simple. Sometimes you have to deal with a dictionary, JSON. And dictionary has a nested inside, maybe one level or two level. For example, a Facebook webhook. Facebook webhook hook back to me with a 5 or 6 hierarchy level, and I have to do a validation before get that data to my system. Yes. I use serializer to do a validation. In the REST framework, it is called a serializer. But if you use an ordinary Django, it is a form validation. And form is clean and cleaned data. And in the Django REST, it is a validated data. Okay. Let's see this. Let me build nested serializer from the bottom up. This is a short item serializer. Short item serializer, and I also introduce you an hyperlink related field. It's a field that represents the detail view of the item you would like to use. Suppose your customer click on the detail, and detail has another detail to go inside. You have an order and has an order item, and order item has a short name. It's so short and it's not difficult. It's difficult to understand what it means. Then your user gonna click it. This link will make that link for you. You don't need to let your front end guy hard code the URL and put it into your app. You just return it back to them and let them grab the value from the key and value of the return response from here. No need to do hard code. Just grab the link returned by back end. Okay, and the menu. Yeah, this is a, that's all for a first short short serializer. And here this is I am going to build a nested one. Nested one with a control read write access. Read write of the data flow. URL is a URL of the record that itself in the list, and then you would like to see in the detail, then don't need to put your own URL, just get the value and click into side, in inside it. Other items has read only and many equal true. Many equal to true let you have the answer back from the backend by a list of dictionary inside. And the menus, and I put write equal to true in order to let the data flow that this view gonna be write only and not present it back when the user hit the endpoint. Whenever you implement your own nested serializer, don't forget to implement your method of a create. And in my case, I use model order in the meta field, always return the same item type, always return the same model type. Okay, as a tip in implement your own nested serializer. When you have validated data, do not forget to use bulk create. Because bulk create will save your database time. Bulk create will get all the instance ready in the list in the memory and then hit the database one time. If you use just create, it will hit database at number of time you as a number of element in the list. It's not efficient. Just hit it one time only to do a bulk create. Okay, this is an example of the output of the nested serializer. Nested serializer will return you by this. This is a dummy tag I made by another library. Then you can see the customer is now because I made it by hacking and added to here. Nested order item, this is a list in the dictionary. You can see the menu inside. If that menu has a name, but name is not enough to visualize the detail in it, just let the mobile has a link for the user to click and see the see the detail inside it. Okay. Next one is a search, filter, and ordering. We are going to see in the detail how to use it and how to consume it. Click on the filter right here. If your configuration is not correct, your import is confused between package of Django filter and Django REST, it will not show up to you. But if you do it correctly, it will show you the thing like this. It's a JavaScript pop up into your browser. And the field, if you reflect directly from your serializer, you can filter the record by the choice that I give to you. Okay, for filter is the same meaning as I told you a moment ago. Filter, you have to have the record that match the same thing, same record. But if you use a search is mean or. If your record has that value or has another one value, if you show up. And the order on any field is a feature come from order filter. I used to have a problem with ordering, and the ordering filter from the REST framework get me the precise feature I want. Frontend guy, mobile guy, web guy, he can use the argument to sort. To do a first level sorting by himself, sort by ID, sort by menu type, sort by name. It doesn't mean to be in the same order. You can use ID ascending, menu type ascending, name descending. You can sort it by your choice. Okay, in case your live is not that so easy. Model is nested. Suppose invoice. In the invoice view set, you have to let your staff have permission to see it, not let your customer be able to see it. And that is the first concern. You have to put permission classes over there and let authenticated and each staff permission over there. I will show you in the inside of each staff permission how to implement your own customized permission base. And for now, I will show you the customized filter first. Customized filter. Okay, and first one, imagine about a use case when customer come to you and say, I'm sorry, I don't know, but this item is not mine. You add an order more than I took. Okay, what's your name? Or what's your surname, please? It can do a forward searching from one field to from one table to another one table. Simply just use double underscore. Order, customer, and user. Because in the order module, I have put a name of a customer in it, and I use following key from customer has and to has a username in it. And look expression is its I contain. Look expression has many value in it. You can use just a contains in case sensitive contain. This is an abbreviation of the letter I. Or you would like to search from the created at or updated that. Suppose that customer said, I don't know what is it, but we know the name of him and we know what time he come to the shop. We can search from the date time field in that. Again, it makes use of a meta class of model, invoice, and field. In the meta class, it has one tip that is common. And also two schools of Django also mentioned that from then Danny. Danny also say explicitly in his book that normally use a field, just put the field name over it. Do not use exclude, because exclude is counterintuitive for a human. And you may surprise that when you add a field to your model, that field gonna pop up in your API or in your serializer automatically without your consent. Then to not let that happen, just use field and name of it. Do not use exclude. Okay, now you have your own customized filter. Put it there in a filter class, invoice filter. Okay, that's all. You are done with your own customized invoice filter. Here is a permission. Permission just simply inherit from the base permission. Base permission has two methods for you to do and implement. First one is a has permission, and second one is has object permission. Okay, remember, recall your get has two meaning. First one is a list view, and second one is a detail view. Get is the way of Django to do a permission evaluation. It will evaluate from has permission first, and then evaluate has object permission. So in this case, I don't need to constrain the user to a particular record. I just let the user be able to consume every record. Then I implement it just has permission. And has permission in here, in this context, request.user, you will automatically get the user instance of the request packet automatically. Next, I can get the each staff property to determine he is a staff or he is just an authenticated user to the system. And return use true or false. True is mean granted, and false is mean permission denied 403. In case you would like to raise your own customized error message, you just choose, just change from return true or false to raise exception. just that. Okay, we're almost there. Python ORM, Python ORM and related name. Suppose you need the invoice, we have order bin, we have cashier, and this is a relational from one model to one another. First one, and order has one invoice. Is it one-to-one? Pay attention on that related name, invoice, has no plural. Is it a singular verb? And cashier, on the keyword, give me related query name. Is it an invoices? Let's see what I am going to show you and how to use it in this way. For example, suppose we would like to see the invoice immediately, and we have only just an order. We use order.invoice to get the invoice in return. You don't need to get the order ID and then query in the invoice database with ID equals something. This is a tedious and generate a several lines of code before get the invoice instance that bind to that order. Just simply put dot invoice, then that's all. Okay, next is a related query name. An ordinary query of it, user objects filter. In a user model, you cannot put invoices into that filter. ORM will reject it and say keyword is not valid in the ORM. But by using that related query name, you will be able to find a user who has that invoice. This is a reverse relation. Save your code and save your time. Okay, push notification. I have only just 3 minutes left. Push notification. Okay, and installation. Installation is very simple. Just pip install. Put into the install app like I told you before. Do one migration. And do not forget to register your account at the FTM. First one is a key server, is a longer one. Legacy key is going to be outdated soon. And the hard part is get your certificate from iOS. This is the hard part. Okay. And this is a setting. Setting put in here and at my application ID, I use a dummy tag name, poi_FCM, and platform is a SVM, and put the key, the last one I showed you before, and I censored the first line. Put it here, just that. That's all to use push notification, easy just that. Okay, and then set up. Go to your Django admin page. For Django admin page, assume you know how to go that way. It's not too difficult, but I have to save my time. Okay, put your device information in there. Put your name, your user, your application ID. It's the dummy tag I told you before. poi_FCM, and then device ID and registration ID. And cloud message type. Always use only just five base cloud message. Do not need to choose any other type. For device and registration ID, device ID is an optional, but registration ID, the bold one, is required. You have to put it. You have to ask the developer who are on that mobile or website He knows how to get this value. It has a ready-made SDK for it. And lastly, Redis. Since I use a third party, and third party do an HTTP call to the next one, my architecture has to support a third party web call, and web call may have a latency and delay when return back to me. I have to dispatch a work from my main process to child process. In order to get my service level agreement in the best time for user. Suppose we have 100 user coming to my system and all of them use push notification. If my server have to wait until the notification is done, I'm gonna lose the SLA. Then what I do is by let the main process dispatch the work to the worker, because notification is not a hurry task. It will be handled by another worker in the system, and let the Firebase do the job for me. Okay, here I have to use Redis in order to get the queue job in the memory. My setup is very simple. No username, no password authentication. It will be clumsy. Is it danger for me? No, because I implemented it in a Docker, and my Docker not expose my Redis to the outside world. It's everything secure by the Docker layer. Okay, run Redis, run your worker, and I set to default. Here is how to dispatch a work to the RQ worker. Just import django-rq.nq, supply the function, supply the argument, that's all. Job will be dispatched to your worker, and worker do the job. Now, and then lastly, return response to your requester. Okay, you did test. At first, I intended to use a pytest, but I would like to shorten my time from the setup because I might running off time. Okay. Test, Django REST, I normally do a test framework and choose the endpoint by this. Use a dummy, and I would like to test a nested serializer in an endpoint. Get the URL and reverse the class name to it. Get the response back and assert. Okay, and Docker. I use Docker in order to simplify every setup into the identical one, and all the development server or any production will be the identical one. The benefit of it is that system as a config. You don't need to have a different environment, a different platform. Okay, this is how you build a Dockerfile. Dockerfile has an advantage over the another system. Let's say 10 years or 20 years backward, system engineer use Bash script to supervise the VM. And then right now we use Dockerfile to supervise the image. Image has advantage that it can build up into a layer, not a VM. VM has about thick one image, but if you store multiple image of a Docker image, it will share and save up your storage cost. And Docker Compose, here is my architecture of the Docker Compose that I use. First one is Nginx. Nginx has wiring to the back end to the worker Redis and Postgres. In that, it has a networking between the container and has a persistent memory. Okay, this is the last section. Any questions?
Yes, okay. Maybe we have like time for one or two questions. Anyone have a question? Okay, there's no question, then thank you very much.